So today we're going to talk about dilutive securities and culminate in class about the earnings per share and the effect on that. So the thing to know is that dilutive securities can be attached to a couple of different things or be considered with a couple of different other types of securities. And that includes stock options, convertible securities, and preferred stock. And sometimes the question is, do we recognize these as liability, equity, or both? Because some of these have components that may fall into both categories. Think about preferred stock. With preferred stock and a cumulative dividend, it functions very similar to a debt. However, it is a stock. So let's start with how we account for convertible debt. Just a few weeks ago, we talked about bonds, and that there were convertible bonds was one of the options. So convertible bonds are able to be changed into a form of other corporate security during a specified time after issuance at the holder's option. So they have the benefit of a bond. They're guaranteed the benefit of a bond. So upon purchase, they can get their guaranteed interest and eventually their principal at maturity. But they also have this extra little option that at some point defined, and it's going to typically be after a specific point from issuance and up to a specific point, they will have the right to exchange it for stock. So they can convert it to a stated number of shares of stock, but they have to initiate that process as the holder of the bond. Now, the two main reasons that corporations issue convertibles is to raise equity capital without giving up more ownership control than absolutely necessary. So they can potentially raise additional equity capital through the conversion and to obtain debt financing at cheaper rates. The conversion option of a convertible bond stands in for some of the additional cost of financing. So instead of having as high an interest rate, they add this extra where you can choose to convert it to stock. So they can issue it at a lower interest rate. When we're accounting for convertible debt, there are three different levels of reporting issues we have to take into account. So first, there's issuance. Then, if and when it converts from debt to equity, and then retirement. So this is retirement of the bonds. So at the time that we actually issue the bond, we do not attribute any portion of the proceeds received to the conversion feature, and do not credit any paid in capital accounts. We use this the same as we would a straight debt issue, with any discount or premium amortized over the debt. The reason for this, even though it has a conversion possibility attached to it, is that it's a possibility and it's at the discretion of the bondholder. So the level of uncertainty attached to it is pretty significant compared to the level of certainty tied to having to pay maturity value at face value at the time of maturity. So just a reminder to illustrate, Miller Corporation issued $4 million par value 7% convertible bonds at 99 for cash. Now, if the bonds had not included the conversion feature, they would have sold for 95. Now, we're giving you a bunch of information. So the first thing you want to do is how much cash was actually received. So it tells us that they sold at 99 for cash. So we take 4 million, multiply that by 99%. and that's going to give us $3,960,000. Therefore, we received cash of $3,960,000. These are bonds payable, so we will be obligated to pay at maturity $4 million. So there's $40,000 that has not yet been recognized. Now, these bonds sold for less than par because they're not 100%. They're at 99%. So that means that we have a discount in play. So the $40,000 goes to your discount on bonds payable, leaving $4 million of liability obligation recognized on the books for this period. Now, had they been selling for 7%, they would have been at an additional discount, an additional 4%, as you can see, because it would have gone from 99 to 95. But having that conversion feature attached to it allowed them to sell for 99. Remember, the conversion feature is an option at the bondholder's discretion. Now, somebody that has purchased these bonds may at some point make the choice to convert based on whatever the terms of the conversion are. And when that happens, we as the company use the book value method for converting the bonds. So when the debt holder converts the debt to equity, they exchange the bond for stocks. The issuing company is not going to have a gain or a loss upon the conversion because we're doing it at book value. So here we have Moore Corporation, and they have outstanding $1,000 bonds, each convertible into 50 shares of $10 par value common stock. The bonds are converted on December 31st, 2017, when they had an unamortized discount of $30,000 and the market price of the stock is $21 per share. So we need to prepare the entry to record the conversion of the bonds. So first, we know that we have a bonds payable account right now of $2 million. That is 2,000 outstanding bonds multiplied by 1,000 face value for each of them. So we need to reduce our bonds payable by $2 million. They also tell us attached to this particular bonds payable in the books is unamortized discount of $30,000. Discount recognizes that these bonds originally sold at less than par value and that the additional cost of financing was being allocated across the life or the term of the bonds. So we need to reduce discount on bonds payable to zero for this issue. And that requires a credit to discount on bonds payable. Next, we have to recognize how much in common stock. So when we have par value on our common stock, remember that is the amount we post to the common stock account itself. So we've got 50 shares for each of the outstanding bonds. So there's 2,000 bonds multiplied by 50 shares multiplied by $10. That means $1 million is going to be posted into the common stock account. Therefore, the residual $970,000 will go into our paid in capital in excess of par common stock. As you can see, there's no gain, no loss recognized. We are just taking our book values at that time. So the book value of the bonds payable at that exact point in time is $2 million minus the $30,000. So it is $1,970,000. That is the equivalent consideration that will be taken in for the common stock conversion. Now, sometimes there can be some inducements to conversion. We would really rather our debt holders convert, and we'd rather them to convert now than at any other point in time. So when this happens, we're trying to not have to pay interest for a specific period of time. We want this to convert to equity because remember, interest payments you have to make. However, dividends are not guaranteed. So we might induce the conversion. This is where the issuer really is trying to encourage conversion more promptly. So what they do is that they offer out what's called a sweetener. This is an expense for the current period of time, and it's usually something along the lines of, they could say, we'll pay you X amount of cash to convert, or it could be an additional amount of stock. It really just depends upon the nature of the sweetener. When an issuer makes additional payments to encourage conversion, the payment is considered the service of the is pay is considered, wow, I apologize. The payment of the sweetener is considered for the service of the bondholder converting at the given time. That's why it's an expense of the current period, and it's not attached to anything that needs to be deferred or accrued. So we have here where Moore Corporation has outstanding $2,100,000 bonds convertible to 50 shares of $10 par value. This is all the same as our last situation. So this is how the bonds themselves will convert to cap to convert to equity at the $1.97 million. But in order to encourage this conversion, because they wanted to reduce their annual interest costs, they agreed to pay to the bondholders $70,000. So we will have a special expense called the debt conversion expense of $70,000 and outgoing cash of $70,000. Now, the third instance that comes into play with convertible debt is retirement. So, this is when that debt retires. We recognize it the same as we would retire any debt that's not convertible. Any difference between the cash acquisition price and the carrying amount should be reported as a gain or a loss in the income statement. Now, that's convertible debt. So this is when we have a bond that can convert to X amount of shares. Those shares are typically common stock, and it'll say X amount of Y value, Y par value common stock. Another type of convertible debt is actually convertible preferred stock. So in this instance, attached as an additional factor of the preferred stock is that it can convert from however many shares it is of preferred shares into another amount, usually, of common shares. Again, this is an option that occurs at the holder's expense. So, as a preferred stockholder, you could say, you know what, I would rather turn this in and I would rather convert it to common stock. Now, you might do this in an instant where, say, for, and you can, once you convert, you convert. You can't go back. You can't say, never mind. So, for example, if your preferred dividends are very low, and frequently and regularly, the common stock dividends are much higher. You may choose to convert to common stock. You would receive a higher level of earnings by taking on that additional risk. This is classified as stockholders' equity. Most of the time, unless there is a mandatory redemption. And there's no theoretical justification for recognizing a gain or a loss when exercised, because you are just swapping out one kind of stock for another. We use the book value method for this as well. So to illustrate that, let's look at Gall, who issued 2,000 shares of $10 par value common stock upon conversion of 1,000 shares of $50 par value preferred stock. So these 1,000 shares of $50 par value preferred stock had attached to it conversion options, and they could convert those 1,000 shares to 2,000 shares of common stock. Now, the original issue for this preferred stock was $60 per share. And common stock is currently trading at $26 per share at the time of conversion. But we're using the book method, the book value method. So first we start off with, we have to reduce our preferred stock outstanding. So we reduce by the 1,000 shares of $50 par value. That's $50,000. And then because this issued at $60 per share, we also need to reduce our paid in capital in excess of par as related to preferred stock by that additional $10,000. That's the $10 times 1,000 shares. We then recognize 2,000 shares of $10 par value common stock. So that's $20,000 that we'll credit. And then the remaining $40,000 will go to paid in capital in excess of par common stock. So at this particular juncture, the current market value or trading per share price of the common stock is moot because we are using the book value method. So we'll go ahead and end this one here. Just give you a little time to look at this information and absorb it, because these different types of conversions, whether they are in this case preferred stock or in this case convertible debt, when they convert from whatever their initial format is. So if it is convertible debt, it has a right to convert to common stock, or it is preferred stock that can convert. In either case, because those can become common shares, they have the ability to impact earnings per share. And we'll talk about earnings per share pretty significantly and go through the steps of how to take all that into account, especially for transparency and disclosure when we're in class. But anytime something can result in an additional amount of common stock shares outstanding, then it can have a dilutive effect. A dilutive effect means that the amount of earnings per share, so the earnings that the common stockholders have the ability to have per share, reduces. It dilutes. The more common stock there is, the less per share there will be.